programme and the opportunities that this will provide for young people and employers in the area.
Thank you. That ends portfolio questions. We are now moving to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15522 in the name of John Swinney on the Budget Scotland No. 5 Bill. Members who wish to speak in the debate should press the request to speak button now. And I call on John Swinney to speak to and move the motion. Deputy First Minister, 14 minutes.
President Officer, last week I introduced the Budget Scotland No. 5 Bill for 2016-17, which will implement the draft budget that I set out in December. I welcome the report of the Finance Committee and I will formally respond in advance of Stage 3 as agreed with the Committee. The budget that is before Parliament today is a budget that promotes growth in the economy and reforms public services. It ensures that the maximum impact is generated from our expenditure and that decisions on revenues raised reflect our principles-based approach to taxation. Public spending in Scotland continues to face significant challenges, with another real terms reduction applied to our total departmental expenditure limit in 2016-17. And looking ahead, the settlement we received in the UK spending review will see the Scottish budget fall, continue to fall in real terms in every year until the end of this decade. The financial context is also set by the continued pressure on household incomes, and the government has been determined since its election to protect household incomes, particularly for low earners. Our longer-term financial decisions are influenced by the expectation of further powers from the Scotland Act 2016. In December, I said the government would set out its longer-term intentions on the use of these new powers before Parliament rises for the election. To use those powers, we need a fiscal framework that delivers on the Smith Commission. It must be a framework that is faithful to that agreement and fair to Scotland. I met the Chief Secretary to the Treasury again this week, and work is going on as we speak to try and reach an agreement. I must, however, be clear with the Chamber. There is a long way to go. There is a significant difference between our respective views, and time is short to reach an agreement. But on one point, I want to be absolutely definitive. I will only sign a deal that is fair to Scotland and consistent with the principles agreed by the Smith Commission. I will not sign a deal that is harmful to the interests of the people of Scotland. President Officer, the budget provides the resources necessary to deliver a strong and sustainable economy whilst tackling economic inequality. It delivers an extensive capital programme that will support our economy, enhance our social infrastructure and help address climate change. It takes forward a bold and ambitious programme of public sector reform, together with our delivery partners, to ensure the sustainability and the quality of our services. And it delivers on our commitments to the people of Scotland at a time of continued pressure on household incomes. In the December budget statement, the government proposed a Scottish rate of income tax for the first time. The limited nature of the income tax power currently available to the Scottish Parliament only allows for a single rate to be set and then applied to all three income tax bands. This means that any increase on the wealthiest would also apply to the lowest income taxpayers. Proposals from other parties to increase income tax by 1p next year will hit those taxpayers least able to pay.
How does that comment match the comment from last month to the Finance Committee when he said, "I view the Scottish rate of income tax as a progressive power. Clearly, people on higher incomes pay comparatively more than people on lower incomes. So surely what he's just said is wrong."
Deputy First Minister.
What I said, if Mr Rennie had been listening, is that the proposals to increase income tax by 1p next year will hit those taxpayers least able to pay. Of course it will. It puts up tax for the lowest rate paid people in our society, whether those individuals are newly qualified teachers, they would be hit by this rise, and police officers and firefighters, postal staff, bus drivers, charity workers, shop workers, hotel workers, workers the length and breadth of the land would see their income tax rise. Now, well, on this point, I'll give way to Jackie Bailey.
Thank you. I wonder whether the Cabinet Secretary would reflect on the fact that teachers are in fact doing their own photocopying, buying jotters for the classroom, that there are no resources in our classroom, and they absolutely... absolutely, they absolutely understand why this is being done. But would he welcome, perhaps, would he welcome the rebate that we've put in place that helps protect those on the very lowest incomes?
Deputy First Minister. Order. Deputy First Minister.
I want to say to the teachers and to the public service workers, the length and breadth of this country, who have had to endure pay constraints because of the austerity programme of the United Kingdom government, that I value the sacrifices they have made, and the last thing I'm going to do is put up their taxes. Now, Jackie Bailey has just raised the issue of the rebate proposal to mitigate the effects of the tax rise. So the immediate conclusion to draw from that very announcement of a rebate proposal is the recognition that this tax rise is damaging to the incomes of low-paid workers. Then there are the legislative and practical issues that would need to be overcome, and overcome quickly, to make that concept a reality from April this year. So, let's go through the detail. Labour will need to clearly demonstrate the legal basis under which they believe such a payment can be made.
Deputy First Minister.
I'm only helpfully going to dismantle Labour's proposal, so they should be quiet and listen. If it's a tax relief, it is outside the powers of the Scottish Parliament in relation to income tax, as conferred by the Scotland Act 2012. If it is a social security payment, that is outside the competence of Parliament, as defined in the original Scotland Act of 1998. Further evidence that this proposal is not properly thought through is provided by the lack of clarity about how it would be administered, and in particular, how it could be done within the £75 million allocated to this proposal by Labour. An estimated 1 million taxpayers, workers and pensioners could be eligible for the £100 rebate, which would cost £100 million, more than Labour have bargained for the rebate, which doesn't even meet the needs of individuals within our society. Now, the second problem is that on top of that would be the cost of setting up and operating administrative systems by 32 local authorities across Scotland. We know already that it costs local authorities many millions to administer help with council tax bills, where the authorities already have a lot of information about the circumstances of claimants. But thirdly, the rebate payment is likely to be counted as income tax for tax purposes, and so those who receive it would be liable to pay tax on it. It doesn't seem too much to expect those who propose policies of this kind to have at least considered these issues. But there seems little evidence this has happened. The only conclusion we can draw is it's unlikely that anyone would receive this rebate on the basis that Labour have offered that proposition to the people of this country. Of course,
Jackie
I'll give
Bailey.
Way.
His speech is very reminiscent of what we heard from his backbenchers yesterday, which is all about detail, all fine aspects of detail. But let me ask him...
Order! Let's hear Miss Bailey.
Frankly, is an excuse for not addressing the question of principle. And I want to know what you think about the principle of what we're proposing, because that, politically, is important.
Deputy First Minister.
I think that was a very, very revealing intervention. Because, you see, the detail matters. Because on the 1st of April, a citizen of this country who was going to have their tax raised by Labour, and they won't have it raised by the SNP, they would have the right to expect that what has been promised by Labour can actually be delivered. And what Jackie Bailey has got to do in her speech today is explain why the legal, practical, operational issues that I have raised are somehow overcome by the back of the fag packet that Jackie Bailey has written this on. This government, presiding officer, will freeze income tax, and we will deliver a pay rise to around 50,000 of the lowest paid workers in Scotland. the uprating of the living wage, its extension to social care workers and an uplift of £400 for those covered by public sector pay policy earning £22,000 or less, will see tens of thousands better off because of this budget. That's the difference. That's the difference between the SNP and Labour. We want to give the lowest paid a pay rise. Labour want to give them a tax rise. I'll give way to Mr McDonald.
Lewis McDonald.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I understand Mr Swinney was too busy to come out of the Parliament today to talk to the local government workers who were lobbying outside Parliament. But since he has reiterated that he has set his face against any increase in tax, what is his message to the 16,000 local government workers who are liable to lose their jobs as a result of £500 million of cuts in the coming financial
year? Deputy First Minister.
What I'll say to those individuals is that the SNP is determined to protect their incomes, not punish them with a tax rise that the Labour Party is coming out with. Presiding officer, this budget reaffirms this. Well.
Neil Findlay.
Presiding officer, no afternoon would be complete without Mr. Findlay.
Mr. Findlay.
It's fairly simple. How can you protect their income when they don't have a job?
Deputy First Minister. Deputy First Minister, let's hear the Deputy First Minister.
This is the government that's given public sector workers a guarantee of no compulsory redundancies. That's what we've delivered for the people of this country. Presiding officer, this budget reaffirms our commitment to deliver inclusive growth through investment in education and skills. Almost £5 billion is invested annually in delivering school education, with average expenditure per pupil higher in Scotland than in England. The health budget in Scotland will reach over £13 billion. We will protect the budget for colleges within Scotland and ensure that higher education spending is over £1 billion in 2016-17. The Scottish Government is investing £250 million in supporting the integration of health and social care services at local level. The biggest reform in the way in which we deliver health and social care services since 1948. And when we put that money in, that money is designed to do something which I thought the Labour Party might have welcomed, which their local authority leaders might have embraced, might have thought was a good idea, to pay the living wage to social care workers in our country. But what have we had? We've had obfuscation from the Labour Party. We've had all the complaints from the Labour Party about the SNP government doing the right thing to protect people on low incomes in our society. And what we want to make sure is that the reforms of health and social care bring together those important services to expand the social care that's available to members of the public, to deal with the financial pressures that are felt across the system, and to make sure that workers are able to command the living wage. Those are the priorities of the SNP government on health and social care. And as well as doing that, presiding officer, we will maintain 1,000 additional police officers on the streets of Scotland. We will protect the frontline policing budget in real terms next year, and with a further £55 million provided to support a new phase of change and transformation, we will ensure that police services meet the needs of the people of Scotland. And at the time of austerity, we will also inject the resources to protect household incomes from the changes in welfare undertaken by the United Kingdom government. So the investment... The investment we're making on the Scottish Welfare Fund, £38 million, £343 million on council tax reduction, £35 million to ensure that nobody pays the bedroom tax in Scotland. On top of the other commitments to free school meals for our youngest citizens, for free personal care for our most elderly citizens, this is a budget that meets the needs and the expectations of the people of Scotland. It confronts austerity, it protects people, it protects their household incomes, it stands in the face of a rise in people's tax by the Labour Party, and delivers for the people of this country. I move the budget in my name.
I now call on Jackie Bailey. Jackie Bailey to speak to and move amendment number 15522.1. Ms Bailey, 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Politics is all about choices. The SNP today have to make their choice. The budget before us today is an austerity budget. And so far, John Swinney has chosen to pass on austerity rather than to break from austerity. Yeah, but you know, it doesn't need to be this way. There is a real opportunity here, a chance to do things differently. The SNP can make different choices, and our amendment shows the way. We have new powers now and new powers coming. And I ask the SNP to work with us to use these new powers to invest in our children, invest in Scotland's future, and keep the promise you made to the Scottish people time after time, that more powers meant the chance to do things differently and to make fewer cuts. The SNP believed in that during the general election, when they set out plans to end austerity that they wanted an incoming UK government to adopt. So what's changed since last May? Well, let me tell you. You now have the power to do that for Scotland. You can deliver real change right now. In a minute. This is about our future, and I am I'm ambitious for Scotland. I want to see a growing economy. I want to see our young people do better than the generation that went before them, better skilled for the jobs of tomorrow in the industries of the future. But you don't get that without investing in your people and specifically in their education and skills. Investing in education is one of the most significant ways of growing our economy. And we have a lot of catching up to do. If you take a look of what has happened in education over the last 9 years. 4,000 fewer teachers in our classrooms, 152,000 fewer students in our colleges, classroom assistants gone, not enough young people achieving their potential. What a waste. I'll take the intervention from Mark MacDonald.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. She asks what's changed since May. In the Finance Committee report on the budget...
Order!
Wait for it. The following line 27. The committee supports the Scottish Government's proposal to set SRIT at 10 pence for 2016-17. Jackie Bailey is a member of that committee. That recommendation was agreed unanimously. So I ask her, what's changed since Friday?
Jackie Bailey.
I'm sure that... Jackie Mark Bailey. MacDonald, if he'd been paying attention, would have also recognised I wasn't at that meeting on Friday. Right?
Order!
So perhaps, Presiding Officer...
Order! Order! Let us hear Miss Bailey!
Perhaps Mark MacDonald...
Order! Let us hear Miss Bailey! Ms Bailey.
Thank you. Perhaps Mark MacDonald might want to get his glasses tested. In fact, do you know, turning back to education, under the SNP's watch, spending on education has fallen by 8% for preschool, 11% for primary school, 4% for secondary school. Put simply, that's £561 less per head spent on our school children. Now, that isn't a picture of a government investing in our economy or in our future. The SNP have also cut the central education budget by £130 million. They also want to cut the local government budget by at least £350 million. And as education is local government's biggest budget, it is inevitable that there will be more cuts to come. And make no mistake, the big losers in John Swinney's budget are local communities, local schools, and the local public services that people value. The budget cut to local government is hundreds of millions of pounds. The UK government has cut the Scottish government budget, but John Swinney has taken that cut and doubled it before passing it on to local government. That's austerity on stilts, and it is John Swinney's choice to do that. But don't worry, as the First Minister told us, this is all simply reprofiling. So when is a cut not a cut, Presiding Officer? Of course, when it's reprofiling, expect to see that word used quite often in future. But the share of local government spending is down to 30%. That's a further drop of 1.7% compared to last year. Gone is the concordat and mutual respect. Gone are the warm smiles and the handshakes. Now it's all threats and draconian sanctions and a complete disregard for local democracy. The temperature in relations is near freezing. And when I am told by John Swinney that he's been very generous and fair to local government, I point... Listen to this point first, then you can respond to it. I point to the 40,000 fewer public sector workers, the GMB estimating 8,000 more to go, COSLA suggesting it could be 15,000. If this was a private sector closure, presiding officer, you would have MSPs on their feet in this chamber demanding that task forces are set up. So, John Swinney, where is the task force to save local services and local jobs from your cuts?
Deputy First Minister.
I'd only point out to Jackie Bailey that employment in Scotland is at its highest level. And secondly, Jackie Bailey knows there are three elements to the local government package that I've required them to sign up to. The council tax freeze, the integration of health and social care, and the protection of teacher numbers. Which one of those does Jackie Bailey object to?
Jackie Bailey.
Can I say, John Swinney threatens the law. And can I also say to him, I will, if they're silent.
Order. Right?
I did not hear a denial of the 40,000 public sector workers that have lost their jobs. The workers protesting for their jobs and their communities outside are looking to us in this chamber. Where were the SNP ministers or the backbenchers? John Swinney wouldn't even meet with the trade unions to consider the impact of cuts. And let me touch on the living wage for care workers, something that Labour members have been demanding for some time now.
I don't think Ms Bailey's
got way, Mr... councils like Renfrewshire have been delivering and leading the way on. But let me say, in all honesty to John Swinney, is it fair to deliver a living wage for workers paid for by sacking thousands of their colleagues? Presiding officer, many of us joined trade unionists from the GMB, Unite and Unison and councillors from across Scotland outside the Parliament today protesting against the cuts to local government. But they've done more than simply protest. They've been positive in offering alternatives, trying to find solutions. Unite have suggested a debt amnesty. Unison have suggested changing how councils borrow, both of which would realise savings. The GMB have worked alongside local councils to protect services. All of them care about the future of their communities, and they know that the cuts to come in years 2 and 3 are potentially even worse than this year. No wonder John Swinney didn't want to do a spending review and has hidden the cuts to come. But it is time for grown-up politics. It is time to choose. Presiding officer, Rory Mayer, the outgoing chief executive of COSLA, said, if you self-deny the ability to raise more money and decide that the way to deal with the downturn in resources is to cut, however you dress it up, that is an austerity budget. And too true. Given the choice between using our powers or making cuts to our children's future and our country's future, we choose to use our powers. Scottish Labour would use the tax system in a fair way, raising the Scottish rate of income tax by a penny to avoid making cuts to local schools and local communities. Income tax is by its very nature progressive. An army of experts tell us this, and even John Swinney clearly. People on higher incomes will pay comparatively more than people on lower incomes. His words, so there you go. But by proposing a rebate of £100 to those taxpayers earning between the £10,800 threshold and £20,000, we make it even fairer and even more progressive. I have heard SNP MSPs opposed to increasing tax in principle pretend that this is about detail, and I heard it from the Cabinet Secretary as well, when it's really about the decision.
Ms. Bailey's in the last 30 seconds.
We have done the detail. We have done the detail. Leaders in councils... I am happy.
Order.
I am happy to share and discuss the detail with John Swinney. But let me say to him, Presiding Officer,
time to end
leaders
up with
in councils, leaders in councils across Scotland who already make payments have made clear they are ready, willing and able to do this. So stop pretending it's too difficult. Presiding Officer, it's not too late for the SNP. We could work together to end Tory austerity in Scotland. You used to want to do so, to invest in our children, to invest in our economy, to invest in our future. Let me say to John Swinney, don't persist with the cuts. For all his noise, he knows how painful these cuts are, and he knows he doesn't have to do this. Let's use the powers we have, because faced with the choice of using our powers to invest in the future of Scotland or continuing Tory austerity, because that is exactly what he's doing.
You need to
there
close,
is no
Ms. Bailey.
Contest. We choose to use our powers. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Kenneth Gibson to speak on behalf of the Finance Committee. Mr. Gibson, you have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And it is with pleasure I speak on behalf of the Finance Committee in the Stage 1 debate on the Budget Bill for 2016-17 and to our draft budget report published last Friday. Scrutiny of the draft budget always works to a tight and demanding schedule. This year's timetable is even more challenging than usual, as the Scottish Government had to await publication of the UK Government spending review in late November before introducing its own budgetary proposals. I'd like to thank all those who contributed to our scrutiny, particularly given these challenging circumstances. As most members are aware, we approach budget scrutiny on the basis of four principles: affordability, the wider picture of revenue and expenditure and whether they are appropriately balanced; prioritisation, a coherent and justifiable division between sectors and programmes; value for money, the extent to which public bodies spend their allocations well in achieving outcomes; and budget processes, integration between public service planning, performance and financial management. This year we concentrated our scrutiny on affordability and budget processes. Historically, budget scrutiny focused almost entirely on government spending plans with little consideration of taxation. However, the devolution of some tax powers and the expectation of more to come fundamentally changes this process and caused us to reassess it. We considered the land and buildings transaction tax and landfill tax in detail last year, and this year a key element of our scrutiny has been on the Scottish rate of income tax. Subject committees considered government spending plans in their areas, and we recommended they examine the extent to which public bodies are adopting a priority-based budgeting approach to deliver those outcomes set out in the National Performance Framework. The committee welcomes the work of subject committees in making the shift towards a more outcomes-based approach. I thank them for their helpful contribution to our scrutiny process. To enable us to hit the ground running when the draft budget was published, we issued separate calls for written evidence in addition to taxation on the work of the Scottish Futures Trust and progress in delivering preventative spending. I thank all who submitted evidence. Given the new tax powers, for the first time we questioned the Deputy First Minister over two sessions. The first considered government tax proposals in detail before we scrutinised its spending proposals at an external meeting in Pitlochry. This worked well, and we will consider the need for further changes to budget scrutiny as part of our legacy report. In Pitlochry, we also held workshops with representatives of local businesses, voluntary organisations and public bodies, hearing firsthand about the impact of public spending on their community and how spending should be prioritised. Key issues raised included flood prevention, access to high-speed broadband, transport, housing and community empowerment. Nevertheless, given the topicality and importance of issues relating to taxation, I intend to largely concentrate on these, although I will also briefly touch upon the work of the Scottish Futures Trust and on delivering prevention. Other members will wish to discuss the government's spending priorities, and I look forward to hearing from them. Turning firstly to affordability, the committee considered the need for a balanced budget with expenditure no greater than revenue. The draft budget proposes to apply a 10 pence rate of Scottish rate of income tax, meaning Scottish taxpayers will continue to pay the same rate of income tax as those in the rest of the UK. To inform our consideration of this issue, we held several oral evidence sessions in the autumn. One or two witnesses favoured a reduced rate of SRIT on the basis that this would act as a stimulus to the wider economy boosting jobs and growth. Others advocated an increased rate on the basis that higher revenues could be used to reduce inequalities. However, a clear majority of responses supported the maintenance of the 10p rate for 2016-17, citing factors such as complexity for employers, mobility of labour, the economy's ongoing but incomplete recovery from recession, impact on a workforce that has endured below inflation pay rises in recent years, and the blunt nature of the power. Having considered the matter in detail in our report, the committee unanimously supported the government's proposal to set SRIT at 10p for 2016-17. Nevertheless, we heard some innovative proposals for changes to taxation going forward and recommended a wide-ranging debate across Scotland on taxation policy and anticipation of expected new financial powers from April 2017. To inform such a debate, one of our key recommendations is that future decisions on taxation policy must be informed by behavioural analysis. Expert witnesses explained how taxpayers could be expected to change their behaviour in response to tax changes. Evidence from around the world suggests that higher rates of income tax are likely to lead to behaviours that impact negatively on tax revenues, including reductions in labour supply, tax avoidance and migration. These behavioural responses are particularly important in relation to high earners, who are more likely to have the means, mobility and motivation to change their behaviour in response to tax changes. Professor David Bell told us that the highest 10% of taxpayers pay more than half of income tax revenues, while the top 1% contributes around a fifth. He estimated around 11,000 additional rate taxpayers in Scotland. As such a large proportion of tax revenue depends on a relatively small number of taxpayers, the committee was clear it is imperative that the potential impact behavioural response on tax revenues is assessed before changes to taxation policy are made. Ultimately, the intention underlying of the devolution of tax powers is that this Parliament will be responsible for raising more of the money it spends and thus be more accountable to the electorate. Nevertheless, a large part of its income will continue to be dependent on the block grant, and as members know, the mechanism by which it will reduce to compensate for devolved tax powers is of supreme importance to Scotland's future financial well-being. We have consistently raised concerns about the impact of relative population growth on the indexation of the block grant adjustment. We therefore welcome the fact that the Deputy First Minister supports the index deduction per capita method, and we recommend that this method is agreed in the fiscal framework which will underpin the devolution settlement. Members will not need reminding that time is of the essence in agreeing the framework if Parliament is to scrutinise it prior to dissolution. We look forward to questioning the Deputy First Minister and Chief Secretary to the Treasury on the framework in the coming weeks to consider if it meets criteria agreed by the Smith Commission and, importantly, is fair to Scotland, the rest of the UK and meets the no-detriment principle. The Finance Committee has consistently raised concerns about the lack of transparency in relation to block grant adjustments arising from the devolution of financial powers, and we believe that full transparency is an essential element in securing public confidence in the process. It is therefore imperative that the fiscal framework contains detailed explanations of how the block grant will be adjusted in 2016-17 and beyond. Regarding taxes already devolved, we have closely followed developments in the first year of their operation, particularly regarding land and buildings transaction tax. Stakeholders raised concerns that LBTT had a negative effect on sales at the higher end of the property market. Whilst it is not possible to fully assess LBTT's impact before outturn figures for the full year are available, latest indications are that high-value sales are returning to previous levels, whilst according to Euromove Acadata, the middle and lower tiers of the market have been given a new lease of life by the government's approach. On this basis, we are supportive of the proposal to maintain the current rates and bans for residential LBTT. However, we also recommend that the government conducts and publishes a review of LBTT once outturn figures for its first year of operation become available. This will doubtless assist Parliament in its scrutiny of next year's draft budget proposals regarding LBTT. Members will be aware that the committee takes a keen interest in the Scottish Fiscal Commission's work. Indeed, stage two proceedings on the bill, which puts the Commission on a statutory basis, take place next week. I look forward to discussing issues raised in our stage one report then, and therefore do not intend to discuss the Commission at length today, but do reiterate a recommendation that greater clarity is needed on the role of the Commission and how it works in practice, particularly regarding whether it is asked to agree the forecasting methodology prior to publication of the official forecasts and what happens if it does not. Regarding the Scottish Futures Trust, we invited written evidence on how successful it is in achieving its stated aim to improve the efficiency and effectiveness of infrastructure investment and use in Scotland by working collaboratively with public bodies and industry, leading to better value for money and improved public services. The overwhelming majority of responses were positive and indicated a high level of regard for the SFT, its staff the professionalism and collaborative approach. Suggestions on how the SFT could further improve its work were also made, and we look forward to hearing the SFT's views on these in due course. Staying with capital investment, an issue around which ongoing concerns have been raised relates to the impact of the European System of Accounts 2010 regulations, which have led to certain non-profit distribution projects being reclassified as public sector spending. We note that £398 million was allocated from the Capital Departmental Expenditure Limit budget in 2016-17 to cover NPD projects, and believe it vital that full transparency is provided on the impact of reclassification, particularly where it resulted in delays to other planned capital investment projects. This is no doubt relevant to those fiscal framework negotiations relating to additional borrowing powers, and we would welcome an update from the Deputy First Minister. The committee continues to scrutinise the Government's commitment to a decisive shift towards prevention, a subject in which we have long taken an interest. Whilst there is evidence of progress, the committee remains frustrated by the lack of evidence of any large-scale shift towards prevention. We received over 40 responses to a call for evidence on the topic, with several highlighting perceived barriers, including a lack of shared ownership among public sector partners. It is clear that if the decisive shift towards prevention does not take place, public bodies will face growing demands for services against a backdrop of finite and possibly diminishing resources. The committee therefore agreed to take further evidence on prevention before reporting our conclusions by the end of this session. Presiding Officer, I said at the beginning that the committee's budget scrutiny focused on affordability and budget processes. Many other topics were also covered in the report, and I am sure other members will raise these later in the debate. I hope to have given a flavour of the increasingly broad range of subjects considered by the Finance Committee as part of our draft budget scrutiny, and I look forward to hearing from other members.
Thank you very much. And to now call Murdo Fraser, maximum 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Deputy First Minister is fond of telling us the extent to which he is a victim of so-called Tory austerity from Westminster. So I thought it might be useful just to ask Spice where the total Scottish Government budget for 2016-17 stands in relation to previous years. And what they told me is that the total budget for 2016-17 will be higher in real terms than in every year of devolution from 1999 to 2007. It will be higher than in each of the years 2011-12, 2012-13 and 2013-14. And in cash terms, it will be nearly £400 million higher than in the current year. Now, we know the Scottish Government will always complain that they do not have enough money. And we know they will always put the blame for this at Westminster's door. The difference in this budget is that the Finance Secretary could have made the choice, if he wished, to increase taxation, and he chose not to do so. Those of us with long memories in the Chamber will remember the Scottish Parliament election in 1999, when a fresh-faced Mr Swinney was the architect of the Penny for Scotland campaign. Something of an irony that we are here 17 years later, and that very campaign has now been taken up by Labour and the Liberal Democrats, and it's Mr Swinney holding the line against increases in income tax. Now, he is right... No, I won't. Thank you. He is right to do so. No. The Scottish Conservatives
Mr Stewart,
believe,
the Member said no.
The Scottish Conservatives believe, as we have often said, that people in Scotland should not be more highly taxed than people in the rest of the United Kingdom. And sometimes that was a lonely message to put out, Presiding Officer, but no more. It gladdens my Tory heart to hear these self-proclaimed Social Democrats and political progressives on the SNP benches arguing so vigorously and so passionately against increases in taxation. Presiding Officer, we on these Conservative benches are happy to stand shoulder to shoulder with the SNP in holding the line against the tax grabbers on the Labour benches and the Liberal Democrat benches who would clobber Scottish families. To coin a phrase, Presiding Officer, we are happy to be better together with the SNP on this issue. But the SNP can hardly complain about Tory austerity when they had the choice to do otherwise. And what this means, Presiding Officer, is that in the coming election,
Order,
for those
please.
Who are unionist voters
Order.
And for those who voted no in the referendum, there is now only one party which will protect their pockets and their household incomes, and that is the Scottish Conservatives. Yeah. Now, Presiding Officer, in our approach to the budget, we have determined...
Willie. Order, please.
Oh, yes, Mr Rennie, yes, of course.
Willie Rennie.
Tax grabber.
I've studied the Conservative proposals for the budgets. They comprise £189 million in tax cuts and spending increases, but I can only see £50 million worth of cuts. That's to the bus pass. Where's the rest of the money come from? And how is he going to pay for
Murdo
it?
Fraser.
Rennie had studied our proposal in detail. He will have seen that we challenge some of the assumptions made in Mr Swinney's budget about the revenue he is likely to raise. For example, we know on LBTT he is, according to the OBR, £42 million behind his projections. So we think some of his sums are wrong. We also would make different choices. As Mr Rennie well knows, we would introduce a graduate contribution. For example, we've been very clear about that. So if he studies in more detail, he will see that we have a package of proposals. I'm just going to come to spell out in more detail why these are important. Because we have determined that our priority should be the Scottish economy. A strong and vibrant economy is essential, not just for the economic and social benefit of the people of Scotland, but also as a means of generating the tax income that the Scottish Government requires. And this will be particularly important in the coming year and in subsequent years, as a closer link between Scotland's economic performance and the Scottish Government's tax take is established. And with this in mind, we have proposed a number of changes to the budget. I'm glad Mr Rennie was paying attention. Firstly, we have concerns about the increase in non-domestic rates in the draft budget. Firstly, with a doubling of the large business supplement from 1.3% to 2.6%. And notwithstanding the title, this will hit many relatively modest businesses, applying to properties with a rateable value of £35,000 or more, representing what would be a relatively modest shop in many Scottish high streets. Now, the First Minister has told us she wishes to see Scotland become the most competitive part of the UK in which to do business. Unfortunately, having a supplementary rate double that payable south of the border flies in the face of this. And perhaps more worrying are the proposals to change empty property relief, to end the exemption of industrial property. The view has been expressed to us very strongly by the business community that this will be extremely damaging, that it could bring to a halt speculative industrial development and may even lead to the demolition of 1 million square feet of empty factories. And this is important because a vibrant, dynamic economy does need a stock of empty properties to allow new and expanding businesses to move into. And we share the concerns of the business community about the adverse impact these changes will have on our potential for economic growth and our ability to attract inward investment. We have concerns about LBTT, which I've spelt out. We believe there should be an increase in the threshold for the 10% rate, and we maintain the opposition we've had in recent years to the cuts in college funding, which have seen a fall of 153,000 college places, particularly impacting on those trying to get back into the workforce, such as women. Presiding officer, our package of proposals would put the Scottish economy first and foremost, always conscious of the fact that a growing economy is necessary to widen the tax base and increase the tax take. Our intention is to abstain on the budget at stage one tonight to allow further discussions to take place. But we are very clear that we in this party will not support proposals to increase taxation, and we shall be more than happy to go into the coming election as the only party, if necessary, defending hard-pressed Scottish households who feel they are already contributing quite enough to government coffers. That is a distinctive Conservative message.
Thank you. We now come to the open debate. It's speeches of 6 minutes at the moment, but that may have to change as we're very tight for time. Before I call the first speaker, though, can I just remind everyone in the chamber that the code of conduct dictates that you do not turn your back on the chair. If members could please bear that in mind for the rest of this debate. I call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I would like to welcome this budget and in particular to highlight one particular aspect of it, which is the £250 million health and social care package. I think it bears particular scrutiny because it is the greatest shift in health spending that we've seen since 1948, and it puts our talk about preventative agendas into practice. You would think that there should be a consensus in the chamber about the £250 million for health and social care, particularly since Mr Swinney has specifically said that it should go to provide a living wage for care workers. It's an issue that's been raised repeatedly in the chamber because it tackles not just a living wage for care workers, that in turn tackles delayed discharges in hospitals, it delivers quality of care in the packages, it speeds up the delivery of those care packages, increases the number of care packages, and of course By increasing wages to care workers, you improve job satisfaction, there's less churn in the sector, there is less staff shortages, and that of course leads to continuity in care packages, which is again an issue that's been raised repeatedly in this chamber, so that people who are having care packages in the community see the same people. So it's all very good news, but it's been rejected by Labour councils.
Yeah.
Despite and backed up by their political allies on, in this chamber, it's absolutely astounding that they would walk away from this budget, given the number of times that they have repeatedly raised the issue of health and social care and a living wage for the workers in that sector. And you go back 2 years, I'll just finish this point, Ms Bailey. You go back 2 years, Neil Findlay in the Chamber raised a motion in favour of Unison's staff survey, It's Time to Care, and his motion specifically said that we should provide resources to ensure the payment of the Scottish Living Wage, which we have done. Now, in committee, we recently had the Economy Committee recently completed an investigation into low wages, and in that investigation, Labour members of the committee repeatedly asked us to introduce the living wage in the care sector. I'll give way.
Ms McAlpine, who are you giving way to?
I'll give way to Mr Smith.
Drew Smith.
Presiding Officer, and to Ms McAlpine for giving way, given that she quoted Unison and what they've had to say quite rightly about the living wage for social care workers, would she agree with what Unison have also said about the scale of public sector cuts and job losses that will be as a result of this budget? Why is there no task force for the tens of thousands of public sector workers who are going to be put out of a job by this SNP budget?
John McAlpine.
I think when you look in detail at the budget, I think it's absolutely despicable that Labour councils around the country are threatening to sack workers. You know, we're talking about a 12% overall cut, a 12.5% cut to this government's budget under the Tories, whereas councils have been relatively protected, as Mr Swinney says, compared to councils in England. And this package sees a 1% cut. And if the bosses of councils, the Labour bosses of councils, don't have the imagination and the ability to manage that in the same way that Mr Swinney's managed the budget of the country, then I think it's they're doing a disservice to the workers that they claim to represent. Yes, I will.
Jackie Bailey.
The member would tell us what SNP-controlled Dundee Council is doing, issuing notices to 6,000 employees asking them whether they will take redundancy.
John McAlpine.
My understanding of that is completely misleading and misinterprets what's actually happening.
Yeah, but well done.
Labour have pinned their principles to the mast on social care repeatedly
in this
chamber. They've raised the issue of the living wage for healthcare workers. They've raised the issue of delayed discharges. They've pinned the principles to the mast on this, and now their principles are underwater because they've got a chance to implement this, what they say that they want, and they're walking away in order to hurt, as far as I can see, in order, as a last desperate attempt before the election, to try to hurt the SNP. But they're not hurting the SNP. The people that they're really hurting are the long-term sick, the terminally ill, the frail elderly, the disabled, people who are stuck in hospital beds. They're the people that will be hurt if this £250 million social care package is not put in place because their Labour councillors are walking away from it. What's their message to care workers themselves, the care workers that they're denying the living wage to? Not only are they denying them the living wage, they're now threatening to tax them.
Order, please.
As well as threatening to tax them, they're offering these low-wage workers who are not going to get the living wage a rebate. Which we don't even know the legal status of the rebate, but they then have to go back to these Labour councillors and means test their rebate. No, I've already taken two interventions. I'm sorry, I don't
know. The member's closing.
They'll have to go back to these Labour councillors to claim the rebate if it's legal and if it can be introduced. Because, of course, Labour just love means testing, don't they?
Yeah, well done.
Ms McAlpine,
can I just remind them
draw to a close, please?
Yeah, somebody mentioned the trade unions. I would remind them that the TUC found that real wages in Scotland under the Tories had fallen by the equivalent of £1,500. That is the amount of money that we have saved people in the council tax freeze, which again their councillors week after week continue to oppose. Is this NP government
you must close.
Protecting workers in the home care service and everywhere else? And it's a shame that Labour have lost
what used to be the tag
of the Workers' Party.
Before we carry on, can I remind members that if they take over 6 minutes, it's colleagues' time they will be taking up. I will have to reduce the time later. Willie Rennie, please, to be followed by Mark MacDonald.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is the budget of many firsts. The first budget with substantial tax powers. The first without a fixed income. The first where we can increase government spending. The first where there are costed alternative tax proposals on the table. And the first where any pretence that councils have flexibility over their budgets has completely evaporated. It also means that this is the first year that John Swinney has been deprived of his well-worn and rather shabby songbook with the songs that he trots out on these occasions. We value the relationship with our local authority partners. He can't say that anymore. He strong-armed them into submission with a triple whammy of fines worth £408 million. If each of Scotland's 32 councils were to increase the council tax by just £1 each, they would be facing fines totalling £408 million imposed by this SNP government. The historic Concordat is simply history. So what else can't John Swinney sing? We have a fixed budget. Well, he's got flexibility now. If only we had the powers. Well, he's got the tax powers. This is a budget against austerity. Not if he uses the powers and he can do something about it if he does. But his favourite is gone too. These are Westminster cuts. With a triple lock on councils to deny any choice, his refusal to use the powers of this Parliament, he is imposing the kind of budget that he has previously condemned. The people of Scotland will know that his refusal to act means that every single cut to public services in Scotland is a John Swinney cut. He cannot shuck, and he must accept it. He cannot point anywhere else anymore. The £500 million cut to schools and council services, John Swinney's cuts. The loss of 152,000 college places, John Swinney is responsible. The failure to invest to meet our climate change targets, the failure to invest to meet our fuel poverty targets, the cuts to police budgets, mental health services not treated on an equal footing. This is John Swinney's budget, and he must accept the consequences of his decisions today. The Liberal Democrats' case is that the situation is so urgent that we must use the Calman powers that we now have rather than wait for the Smith powers due in 2 years' time. We are recommending that we increase income tax by one penny to deliver £475 million of investment to repair the damage of SNP cuts to education and to make the transformational investment in education. And if Mr Swinney is going to get to his feet, can he explain how he is going to protect the incomes? How he is going to... Well, I'll let him in when I let him in. I will let him in when I let him in.
Order.
How can he protect the incomes of the council workers across the country that he's about to sack as a result of this budget?
John
Swinney. Will he
explain that? Order, please. John Swinney.
I'd be grateful if Mr Rennie would share with Parliament when he was so concerned about these issues, when he was defending the cuts in our budget under the last 5 years of the Conservative-Liberal coalition that took place in this country.
Willie Rennie.
I'm afraid that's in the old songbook. It's not in the new songbook. But Mr Swinney needs to understand that if it was not for the Liberal Democrats cutting tax for those on low and middle incomes, the people in Scotland would be far worse off, far better protected than by the SNP. And it will surprise no one that we proposed to spend more than the Tories at the last general election. We believed that the severe cuts that they are now delivering are unnecessary and would risk the economic recovery. What I am proposing today is consistent with our approach last May. And thanks to the Liberal Democrats in government, those on low and middle incomes have seen reductions of over £800 each year because of the personal allowance increase to over £10,000. In fact, thousands of people have been taken out of tax altogether, a policy I remember members on the SNP benches opposing, not just now.
Mr Rennie's approaching his last minute.
It means that we can increase taxes on higher incomes whilst protecting those on lower incomes. For instance, if you'd have to earn over £19,000 to pay more tax next year compared with this year, thanks to the further rise in the tax threshold. Someone earning over £100,000 a year will pay 30 times as much extra tax as someone on the median wage in Scotland of £21,000. This is a progressive measure that will invest in public service and have a transformational effect on our public services. An investment in a pupil premium, an investment in nursery education, an investment to stop the SNP cuts to our schools, and an investment to protect our colleges from further SNP cuts. That is the investment that we propose with a penny for education. And the progressives, the so-called progressives on the SNP benches, are rejecting.
Please
today,
close.
We will be supporting the Labour amendment this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Mark MacDonald to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Now, I asked Jackie Bailey about the Finance Committee report on the budget, and Jackie Bailey responded by saying that she wasn't at the meeting when we discussed our report. Her argument is somewhat undermined by the fact that the Labour Party were represented at that meeting and the Labour Party signed up to the recommendation on the Scottish rate of income tax contained within the Finance Committee report. However, there is one line in the Finance Committee report which the Labour Party did express dissent from, and it's this. The committee therefore welcomes that the Deputy First Minister now supports index deduction per capita and recommends that this approach is agreed in the fiscal framework. That is the Labour Party opposing the very deal which would ensure that Scotland gets a fair settlement from the fiscal framework within the finance. Well, no. I think it would be unfortunate for Jackie Bailey to try and explain the thinking behind opposing something at a meeting she was not present at. So at this moment,
Ms. Bailey,
I will move on because we took evidence as a committee on the Scottish rate of income tax. Stephen Boyd from the STUC said, "Our point is that at this particular moment in the economic cycle, having been through an historically unprecedented collapse in real wages over the past 5 years, 2016-17 is not the moment in which to increase taxes on the lower paid." Ruchir Shah of SCVO, "We do not need to increase taxes to invest in prevention. Prevention is something that can be done with budgets now. I do not think that we should look towards the new tax powers as a panacea and as the way to bring extra money into prevention. We need to look at our budgets independently of the tax system." And another quote on the record at that very committee meeting: "The yield that we would get from 1p on the Scottish rate of income tax is actually quite small. Is there not a better argument to be had about shifting the spend within the overall budget, which is substantially higher?" That quote was from Jackie Bailey. So I wonder what it is that has suddenly transformed the opinion of the Labour Party from the September meeting of the Finance Committee, where that evidence was on the record, to the signing off of the Finance Committee report just last week, to today's debate. Perhaps Jackie Bailey can enlighten us all.
Jackie Bailey.
I'm grateful to the member for taking an intervention. He, of course, realises that the yield would be £500 million. Failure to use the Scottish rate of income tax now will lead to a devastating £1 billion of cuts before any new powers come into this Parliament. Does he not regret that as a decision that his Cabinet Secretary
Mark
is
McDonald.
Making?
Well, I can only apologise to Jackie Bailey for quoting her own words at her. That that the yield we would get from 1p on the Scottish income tax is quite small, and is there not a better argument to be had about shifting the spend within the overall budget? But if she wants to change her own position, that is a matter for her. The important element in relation, I'm looking to develop my comments a little further. The importance of this budget, Presiding Officer, and the point that was made by the Cabinet Secretary when he introduced the budget statement to Parliament was about the need for public sector reform, the need to reform in which we deliver services, because we are in a period of ongoing Tory austerity at Westminster, and we are in a position where simply doing things the same as we have always done them is not going to be sustainable in the longer term. We have seen reforms in relation to police and fire. We have seen reforms taking place now in relation to health and social care. It is now time that we look at how services are delivered at a local level, drive forward the shared services agenda, which has been taken forward very well in some areas of Scotland. I think it would be remiss to suggest that some parts of Scotland have not taken a very strategic approach in relation to the shared services agenda. But it would be fair to say that a lot of local authorities are lagging far behind when it comes to looking at public sector reform and the shared service agenda. But the interesting element of this as well is the Labour Party's insistence that the only way that savings can be achieved is through cutting frontline services. Only last week in the Press and Journal, the finance convener of Aberdeen City Council, Labour councillor Willie Young, a man with whom I have my own special relationship, was in the paper boasting of the fact that the council had managed to identify £20 million worth of savings without a single saving coming from the frontline services that the Labour Party today say are the only things that are left to be tackled. So the notion and the idea that there is not savings to be found within local government, different ways of delivering services that could be achieved by local authorities, flies in the very face of what their own councillors are saying. Very briefly.
Drew Smith, briefly, please.
I'm grateful to Mr McDonald, Presiding Officer, since he's fond of quoting other members. Mr McDonald said on the 23rd of April, "We cannot sustain further austerity which results in those with the least being hurt the most." My belief is that we need to see a commitment to public spending increases. Where does Mr McDonald propose
Matt
we raise
McDonald.
More money for public services?
Indeed, and we put forward... I'm always grateful when Labour members are a fan of my early work. But the point that I would make to Mr Smith... The point that I would make...
Order, please.
Smith,
we must hear Mr McDonald close.
Mr Smith, listen, is that we put forward a very... We put forward a comprehensive, costed package for how a Westminster government could deliver an alternative to austerity. We did not get the result in the election that we were hoping for in relation to Westminster. Mr Smith's party certainly didn't. And that was what that related to. The point about SRIT and the point where I have always been consistent about SRIT is that I do not believe that it is right that the same increase on tax should take place on those on the basic rate as takes place on the higher
rate. Mr McDonald,
the Labour Party
close.
Disagree with me on that. I suspect the public will disagree with the Labour Party.
Thank
on
you.
That.
If members take interventions, they must take them within their own time. Malcolm Chisholm to be followed by Chick Brodie.
Context is everything when it comes to decisions about tax. And the context today is the biggest cut to local government budgets in my lifetime. The Finance Committee accepts the spouse figure of 5.2% cut to local authority budgets and makes a fairly sharp critique on pages 40 and 41 of its report of the nonsense we've heard from the government about the cut being only 2%. In Edinburgh, that translates into £85 million worth of cuts for the coming financial year. And I'm sure the 2,000 workers who are going to lose their jobs in Edinburgh are extremely grateful that John Swinney is going to protect their non-existent incomes. And I would say to Joan McAlpin, we have a SNP Labour coalition in Edinburgh when she talks about shocking sackings. And I think it would pay her to look at the comments of the SNP leader of Edinburgh Council and what he thinks of the government's settlement for local government. So that's the context in which Labour has made its choice, and it's the same context, of course, in which John Swinney instead has sent an unprecedented letter to local government threatening a further £408 million worth of cuts if they don't accept his whole package, including the council tax freeze. Now, just to be clear what that means, in the past, if councils have not accepted the council tax freeze, in a moment, they would lose the council tax support money. This year, if they don't accept the council tax freeze, they will lose lose the council tax support money, they will lose the social care money, they will lose the teachers' money. That, as the leader of Edinburgh City Council has said, is a democratic outrage. I give way to Joan McAlpine.
Joan McAlpine.
You talk about a £400 million cut. That money includes money set aside for health and social care and money set aside for maintaining teacher numbers. Why should councils get £250 million for health and social care if they're not going to deliver it? It's not a peanut penalty.
Malcolm Chisholm.
It's for a specific purpose.
Joan McAlpine completely misunderstands the point that I made and misunderstands the significance of her Cabinet Secretary's letter, because they would lose all that money just by not doing one thing. For example, the council tax rates, they would lose all the social care money. So that is a completely different point from the one she makes. Now, that is the wider context in which Labour has made its decision. And I struggled for the last 24 hours to understand the SNP's response. This is the government, this is the party that in 1999, at the start of a massive increase in public expenditure from Labour, which all parties welcomed, even the Tories at the time, the start of that process, they supported the Penny Scotland, but the biggest cut we've ever seen to local government, they don't. In a minute. It is also the party that actually very recently supported a local income tax, saying how fair and progressive it was. And we don't need to go back very far, because at the Finance Committee last month, and we've heard this quoted by two speakers already, John Swinney said, I view the Scottish rate of income tax as progressive. So all the rhetoric about a regressive income tax that we've heard in the last 24 hours is merely rhetoric. And what I ask, why are the SNP not looking at the effect on people's actual incomes of the change that we are proposing? And I'll go on to deal with that when Mark MacDonald has had his intervention.
Mark MacDonald.
I'm grateful to Malcolm Chisholm for giving way. The evidence from the STUC was that because of the impact on wages in real terms, 2016-17 was not the year to increase the SRIT. Does he not accept that contention by the STUC?
Malcolm Chisholm.
Well, it's certainly not what Stephen Boyd was saying yesterday, and I've heard many speakers from the trade unions in the rally outside a couple of hours ago who were certainly not saying that. But the point I was making before that intervention was, let's look at the effect on incomes. David Eisner, I'm sure Mark MacDonald respects him as a good economist that he's heard at the committee, said, in assessing the progressiveness of an increase in SRIT, the Scottish rate of income tax, it is more relevant to consider the change in after-tax income, which is understandable, than the change in the amount of tax paid. So £12,000 income, and this is without the rebate, your income falls by 0.2%. 23,000, 0.6%. 50,000, it falls by 1%. 100,000, it falls by 1.5%. And as Willie Rennie said, on 100,000, you're paying 30 times more tax than someone on the medium income. And if you add in the rebate, of course, then, of course, that's even better for those earning up to £20,000. And what John Swinney said about our proposals, and that is exactly what he said when we were saying local government could deal with this for the bedroom tax. And because of that, of course, the local authority administration systems are already in place. I've no time. I'm in my last minute now. So I'm still struggling to make sense of the Scottish Government's position on this, except that it's electoral calculation. That is the top and bottom of it. And what I say is, and what we say is, it is better to do what is right rather than to second-guess the electorate. Nothing is more important for the future of Scotland than education, and I would expect the SNP to agree with that, because clearly that is crucial to the growth of the economy as well as to individual opportunity. And we are saying now, in the current context, in the current circumstances of unprecedented cuts on local government budgets, half of which are education, the right thing to do is to raise more income, and of course that is doing it in a progressive way. So the choice before the people of Scotland today and next May is a penny for Scotland or double austerity with the Tories and the SNP.
Thank you. I now call Chick Brodie to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you.
Order, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy to participate in this debate today, and I did so in the forlorn hope that we could have a clinical and analytical review of alternative proposals. I was not hopeful, and I was right. So, Presiding Officer, with that reflection, let's try to understand the basis of this budget, why we are here at the present, what has happened in the recent past, because if we don't do that, then there is little hope for any meaningful alternative proposals in the future with powers to come. And I have to say, I have to credit the Deputy First Minister for facing the challenges not just of this budget, but for those that he produced over the last 8 years. So to understand the budget, why are we here? Well, Willie Rennie did his Pontius Pilate job of saying it had nothing to do with me, Gov. He obviously doesn't understand the economic cycle, otherwise he'd get on it. We're here because the UK has run up a mountainous debt of £1.6 trillion. We're here because the UK Chancellor said he was committed to a large budget surplus by 2019-20. As a consequence of current fiscal arrangements, we're here because the Scottish Dail budget will fall by 4.2% in real terms between 2015-16 and 2019-20, and has fallen by £2.7 billion in real terms in the period 2010-2016. No, not just now. And we're here because Scotland's capital budget is also, despite George Osborne's claim to increase capital spending, it will be £600 million less, 70% lower than it was in 2010-11. That's why we're here, because under the current fiscal arrangements, we are hitched to the application of a Tory austerity programme, an austerity of choice, not one of necessity, and not one that has to be applied with the immediate haste that is doing so. And no, not just now. And it will get worse. The OBR forecast, the forecast that put forward in the November budget, all of a sudden, 6 weeks later, says GDP will be now 2.2% less than forecast in that budget. The balance of payments deficit in November was double that of the balance of payments deficit in November 2014. Borrowing at the end of December was £69.3 billion. Almost that being the total forecast for the whole of the financial year to March. That's why we are here, and yet we have a Scottish budget that recognises these factors, I believe, and then considers the balanced priorities and also considers risk aversion. And I'll come to these in a minute, Presiding Officer. So what are the alternatives? Now, the Tories, be fair to them, will cut taxes, or at least maintain them. Oh, and they will also cut benefits further, given that scenario I've just painted in the face of crippling debt and a challenging global economy. Now, Labour, as we've heard, say they will increase income tax rates by a penny in the pound. A sure sign they know that they will not be in a position to implement it, because it is regressive and it's unfair. So they should tell us, give us the details. Give us the details. Let me just ask some questions and I'll give way. What's the impact on pensioners? What will be the percentage change? What will be the percentage change on net disposable income for those on £20,000? That includes teachers, police officers, nurses, and those who are on £100,000. What will it cost to administer? How much tax is to be paid, as the Finance Secretary said, on rebate? How will they respond to Stephen Boyd? And he may have changed his view, but at the Finance Committee, he said keeping the Scottish rate of income tax at 10 pence made sense. So I'll give way now to Lewis MacDonald.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm very grateful to Mr Brodie. I'm sure he'll recognise the SDUC said yesterday that Labour says a serious proposal that should be given serious consideration. I'm sure he also recognises what we've said about rebates for pensioners and those in the lowest incomes. Can Mr Brodie tell us if he regards income tax as being a regressive tax, what does he regard as being progressive?
Mr Brodie, I don't know if you heard Mr MacDonald, because he turned away from his microphone, but if you did hear him, then it's your opportunity to speak again.
When I get questions like that, it reminds me that Labour's and its associates' weapons are boomerangs. Can I finally, however the balance, whatever
order,
we say,
order,
however
please.
The balance, the budget, You cannot deny additional investment. We've talked about the redirection of spending in care, delivering substantial investment in educational attainment. No, I don't have time. In pursuing and continuing to pursue national security. All of that underpinned by a long-term economic growth platform supporting internationalisation, research, innovation, partnership, growing small businesses and social enterprises. And I say, if I may finish off by saying this to local authorities, I believe that this budget is realistic, but it's tight because of the circumstances, but it is not anti-austerity. And if I may, finally, Presiding Officer, as I say this to local authorities, as Charles Kettering said, if you're doing things the way you always did, then you're doing them wrong. This budget, these times, give us the opportunity to address and create a productive Scotland by looking at how we share services, how we become lean and mean by disposing of underutilised or non-utilised assets that require maintenance, by procurement through the entrepreneurial spirit of the third sector, social and community enterprises.
Please close, Mr Brodie.
Is it tough? Yes, it's tough. But when the going gets tough, the tough get going.
Yeah. I now call Patrick Harvey. Mr Harvey, I can give you 6 minutes thereafter. I will need to reassess the time available.
Thank you. That's quite an act to follow, Deputy Presiding Officer. I like, as the Deputy First Minister knows, I like to give a fair bit of credit where it's due on these occasions. And on this occasion, I want to say something positive about both the government and the Labour position. The government is due some credit for its position on ensuring that the living wage should be given to care workers, including those who don't work directly for local authorities. This is something which the...
Order, please.
This is something which the... if you let me make some progress, this is something which the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee's inquiry into fair work was deeply concerned about, and we heard evidence about the impact that poverty wages in this sector have. Now, I disagree with some of the context, a great deal of the context in which he's doing it, but the point is that these workers are due the living wage, and we should be grateful that that's going to happen.
Richard Simpson.
Thank the member for giving way. The question is, who's going to pay for the living wage? We're all agreed it should be there. But we're being told that the voluntary organisations are going to have to meet 25% of the costs. After years of being strapped for cash, that's going to be very, very difficult and challenging for them.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. I agree with that point very strongly. All I'm saying is I like to say something nice to each side at the beginning of my speech. I will move on, I promise. The Labour Party, and to be fair, the Liberal Democrats, are due credit as well for acknowledging a truth which has become increasingly unavoidable, not just this year, but over the last several years. That if we want to protect public services, local and national public services, we are going to have to raise the revenue that is necessary to do it. And simply managing cuts from Westminster and blaming a UK government, which is, to be fair, culpable for the deeply wrong and damaging actions that it's taking, it's not enough simply to know who to blame. We have to know what to do about it. And raising revenue is going to be an important part of the response. Now, I don't share the specific proposal that's coming from Labour or the Liberal Democrats about how best to do that. The emphasis only on income is inadequate from my point of view. Wealth inequalities are even starker in Scotland than income inequalities. Wealth must become a bigger part of the taxation picture, not a smaller one. And we've had many debates over the years on the role of central government versus local. This proposal would make local government more dependent, not less, on grants from central government. Over the coming weeks, the Scottish Greens will set out proposals for the longer-term approach, including with the more sophisticated tax powers, which we hope will be devolved. That will include income tax as well as wealth tax, but also, critically, local empowerment. In the shorter term, meanwhile, we have already proposed an end to the council tax freeze and an end to the financial penalties that the Scottish Government threatens local authorities with if they don't comply. I also proposed this morning, in amendments to the Land Reform Bill, means of achieving something in excess of £300 million per annum additional revenue from taxing derelict land. The Land Reform Minister didn't agree with those proposals, but has agreed to discuss the issue further, and I hope that that discussion will be fruitful. And I would also suggest that we could use, in the shorter term, the council tax multiplier so that those grossly undervalued luxury properties end up paying a bit more in the shorter term as well. I give way to Lewis MacDonald if he still wants to
Lewis
come in.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm grateful, and I acknowledge that he's now said, I think, that he recognises the need for action in the immediate term. does he recognise that that is the central point of Labour's proposal today, that this crisis in local government funding cannot wait if these services are to be protected and action has to be taken in the coming financial
year? Patrick Harvey.
I agree completely that if we want to avoid the kind of crisis Lewis MacDonald is concerned about, and we are all concerned about, action needs to be taken, and that must mean revenue raising. My proposal is that we do that at local level, as well as ensuring that we properly address the balance between wealth and income taxes, which at the moment, Labour's proposal, I'm afraid, would push the balance too far in the direction of income when it should be going in the other direction. Deputy Presiding Officer, I have written to the Cabinet Secretary on a number of other issues which I hope will be addressed, not least the ongoing shifts within the transport budget. Again, huge, significant increases in road building when we should be emphasising a shift towards sustainable, active and public transport. This is a trend that seems to happen when budgets are going up and when budgets are going down. At a time when the world is apparently moving toward a greater degree of ambition on climate change in the wake of the Paris Agreement, the savaging of the climate change budgets, the lack of any shift towards sustainable transport policies in the Scottish Government's budget, and the dramatic reduction in funding for energy efficiency work, these are not something that the Greens can possibly support. I urge the Cabinet Secretary to give an indication that he's willing to reverse those changes during the scrutiny of the budget, or at least willing to look at how those changes can be reduced in the severity of their impact. I don't say that with the great hope of hearing something positive for the Cabinet Secretary, but my ears will be open. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Linda Fabiani to be followed by Ken McIntosh. You must keep your remarks less than 6 minutes, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start off by putting some of this in context. And some of the context of it is, in fact, the Scottish Government's strong economic record. Because it's there, the proof's there. The employment level in Scotland has reached a record high of Scots now in work. Scotland has the highest employment rate out of the four UK nations and outperforms the UK as a whole. The youth unemployment level and rate fell to their lowest in September to November since 2006. And indeed, the number of registered businesses in Scotland has grown by 12% since 2007, along with Scotland's productivity rate from the same time. Not only that, our international exports have increased by 36%. Between 2007 and 2014. So this government does have a strong economic record and has delivered balanced budgets over its time in office. You know, you can contrast that to some of the stuff that's been going on with Labour recently, which I would say is largely a confusing position that they put forward. Instead of putting forward positive things for discussion at budget time that I'm sure John Swinney would listen to very carefully, what we get is a scattergun approach with anything will do for a headline in the paper. Even looking at what we've got just now, for example, it was only in December that Jackie Bailey herself, Labour's finance spokesperson, said on Scottish television, we agree that it is a blunt instrument, when she was talking about, yes, of course.
Jackie Bailey.
Perhaps the member would agree that we've sharpened that instrument by introducing a rebate to make it more progressive and more fair.
Linda Fabiani.
Well, that's an interesting one. I noticed that earlier on Jackie Bailey said that the detail would be provided, and I very, very much look forward to that detail, because that position has very much changed. Same as Mark MacDonald pointed out, Labour's position changed even since Friday. When Leslie Brennan and Jackie Bailey obviously didn't agree any position whatsoever for the Finance Committee. So they can't even agree amongst their own group. So let's look at the context of where it came from, Labour's new policy. 2012 Act, following the Calman Commission, Labour, along with the Tories, agreed a single Scottish rate of income tax. No control over personal allowances, tax bans, tax reliefs or rebates, therefore not progressive. So now they're offering this £100 annual payment. How? I did hear said that we would have the detail, and I really look forward to seeing that. Because it's not a tax rebate or a tax allowance, because that's not allowed. And if it's through local authorities, then it must be a benefit, generally a reserved matter. even if the next Scotland Bill gets enacted. So that's how paid next, how administered. So local authorities again, how will they get the appropriate data? How will they check it? Do people have to apply? We all know that the low take-up of benefits is worst amongst those with the lowest income. Is this yet again a Labour push against universality? All of these issues, Presiding Officer, and many more, will perhaps be explained in detail by Labour in closing, along with the timeline to the 1st of April this year for implementation. It seems to me that Labour's plans are quite definitely all over the place. No,
If it's Neil Bibby,
please.
Linda Fabiani is talking about looking for extra detail. I wonder if she could give us detail on what the SNP are going to do to stop these swinging cuts affecting our communities.
Linda Fabiani.
The SNP are very clear at what they put forward. The detail of John Swinney's budget has that, and it would do Labour better to work with that. Recognise that it's the Tories that are the problem here. Work with us to try and get a better deal and work with the councils to make it better for people all round, instead of coming up with crazy economics that have no backup whatsoever. There is a complete confusion here in what Labour are trying to do. I did say perhaps clarification would be given, because I'm not convinced it will. We've heard so many off-the-cuff announcements from Labour over the last while, full of that literature mentioned often, sound and fury signifying nothing. Every time detail is requested, we move on to something else. I haven't even heard APD mentioned today, yet that is supposed to be the answer to so many issues. That's why, in terms of the current negotiated fiscal framework, which Labour can't agree on either, I have no doubt that the consistency and commitment of the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister will make the correct decision for Scotland. And that's why, in terms of this year's budget, I have no doubt that when the confusion and the incompetent financial and operational forecasting of Labour's proposed policy is contrasted with the record in government and the sound financial management in the hardest of times from John Swinney and his team, it will be seen, it will be widely recognised that this Parliament should in fact agree to the general principles of the Budget Scotland No. 5 Bill.
Thank you. I call Ken McIntosh to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And John Swinney has enjoyed a remarkably long run as Finance Secretary, and he and his SNP colleagues have managed to escape the level of opprobrium and censure some of his budget decisions have merited in that time. But I believe today his luck has finally run out. Today he's finally been found out. Now, I acknowledge that in the past, perhaps assisted by his own personable manner, Mr Swinney's political and financial conservatism has often been charitably or sympathetically interpreted as prudence. This time, most people, and the media certainly, have identified and named his approach for what it is, conservatism with a capital C. The Financial Times headline ran, "Scottish budget follows George Osborne's example," and it went on, "While denouncing conservative austerity policies for squeezing the Westminster Bloc grant for Scotland, Mr Swinney emulated the UK Chancellor George Osborne." Or The Telegraph, "John Swinney's Scottish budget, a Tory copycat. The Finance Minister pledges a Scottish alternative to austerity but refuses to raise taxes and copies a series of George Osborne's policies." Presiding Officer, in what has been seen by many as a step too far, the Finance Secretary has put local government at the centre of his budget and decided to cut a whopping £500 million from locally delivered public services. £500 million to come out of libraries and daycare centres, learning support for the young and care at home for the old. As The Guardian concisely summarised it, taking his cue from George Osborne's budget, the SNP's John Swinney slashed spending for councils. And if SNP ministers or members don't want to hear it from the press, how about from one of their own? SNP councillor Sandy Howitt, referred to earlier by Joan McAlpine. He's the deputy leader of the Council of Edinburgh City Council. And he said, "A cut of this scale would be very damaging for jobs and services within local government generally. The harsh reality is that this will translate to real job cuts that hit real families in real communities. Everyone will be hurt by this." Now, in some ways, This should all come as no surprise to us. The SNP has been cutting support to our communities for years and passing the blame elsewhere. While Mr Swinney and his on-message backbenchers complain bitterly about cuts from the Conservative government, the Scottish Parliament's Information Service has revealed that they passed on double those cuts to our local authorities. What also comes... Mr Mason.
John Mason.
I mean, I wonder if he thinks that John Swinney has been too generous to the health service and he would rather see some of the money moved from the health service to local government?
Ken McIntosh.
As Mr Mason knows full well, that's not the alternative we're proposing. We're proposing that you raise income tax by one pence, protect the low paid and protect our public services. It's an addition, not instead of. Now, what should also come as no surprise is to see Mr Swinney try to deploy his full range of budget tricks and techniques. On housing, he talked proudly of the increase in the affordable housing budget, but a quick glance at the published figures revealed that the overall housing budget is virtually unchanged. In other words, in the middle of a housing crisis, with 150,000 people waiting for accommodation, he's not actually increased support for housing funding, he simply moved it from one column to another. But at least those figures were actually published. On fuel poverty, he tried publishing last year's draft figures rather than the normal outcome figures to hide the fact that he's cutting the budget by £15 million. And when found out, the SNP came up with the most convoluted form of words in which apparently all the spending is down to them, but the cuts are someone else's responsibility. Or worst of all, not giving the figures at all. The SNP like to boast about their commitment to the renewables industry, never away bemoaning any decisions taken at a UK level, despite the fact that the investment comes from UK consumers. But what did we discover? Not in the budget book, but in the subsequent local government finance circular, Mr Swinney has decided to cut business rate relief for the Scottish renewables industry. He didn't even have the guts to tell them. Now, why has he chosen to impose this additional penalty on the sector at the same time he's accusing the UK government of withdrawing support? And can I ask, exactly how much will he raise by heaping a substantial additional cost in a sector when it's already withdrawing from Scotland at a rate of knots because of the withdrawal of the renewables obligation? Presiding officer, there's long been a gap between SNP rhetoric and the reality of SNP ministerial spending decisions. In the past, they have managed, incredible as it may seem to us, to pass responsibility or blame either to George Osborne or onto our local authorities. When employment goes up, it's because of successful SNP policies. When unemployment goes up, is because of Westminster. And today, Mr Swinney opened his remarks with, I thought, misplaced braggadocio, proposing to dismantle Labour's proposal. Well, he then proceeded to pursue and present two of the most feeble arguments I've heard, that income tax is not progressive and that we need to look at the proposal in more detail. Well, on the first, as several speakers have already highlighted, Mr Swinney should check the official report for his own remarks on income tax being progressive before trying to tell us he's changed his mind. And as for the second, everything I've heard today, and I think Chick Brodie summed it all up, brings to mind the words of Edwin Morgan and his admonition to us all to avoid the droopy mantra, it wisna me, or in this case, we canny do it. That poem said to this Parliament that we should avoid being a nest of fearties. That's what they do not want. A symposium of procrastinators. That's what we do not want. Well, Presiding Officer, I fear that's what this SNP have become. If only we had more powers, they say. Well, today we've called them out. Given the choice between using the powers we have or cutting Scotland's future, we choose to use our powers.
Thank you very much. Now call George Adam to be followed by Jenny Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It seems I've taken part in most of the budget debates since my election in 2011, and every one of them has been in the backdrop of the Westminster Tory austerity programme. The Scottish Government continues to deliver for our nation, and this time we find once again that the Scottish Government is mitigating against excessive impacts of Westminster spending cuts. This budget protects our most vulnerable in our society, protects them from the ongoing Westminster austerity programme. But I would like to discuss and address the Scottish Government's record in education. And as we look at it, as we heard yesterday, with the passing of the Education Scotland Bill, closing the educational attainment gap has been a priority of this Scottish Government. Because for far too long, it seemed that the progress of education depended on where you were born, where you lived. And now we have the £100 million Attainment Scotland Fund that quite rightly targets primary schools which serve our most deprived communities. £33 million of this investment is provided this year. This work on educational attainment is happening this year. And let us not forget that in these times of Westminster austerity, we see continued investment in 600 hours of free high-quality early learning childcare offered to all 3- and 4-year-olds. This moving to 1,140 hours by the end of the next Parliament if the SNP government is re-elected. But we still have £1 billion of investment in Scotland's very successful university sector while ensuring that Scottish students continue to benefit from free tuition and the continued commitment on teacher numbers. This is in the form of the £88 million funding package. But that brings me to our local authorities. And as someone who used to work as a local councillor, it's my opinion that local government has received a challenging but fair financial settlement. And with my previous experience as a councillor, I would say it has always been thus, presiding officer. But it is important that our local authorities look at more innovative ways of delivering services, finding ways to be able to deliver these. The integration of health and social care is an example of joint working and ensuring that there is no doubling up of delivery of service. But it is, at its very heart, an opportunity for our communities to get the service that suits their needs. And this is the challenge for local government, presiding officer.
Local government must
lead the way. Innovation and delivery of that best practice. I mentioned yesterday during our debate that we had in education that COSLA and other councillors came to the Education Committee and were asked by me what was their innovative plans for education, what was the way they were going to work together to make that difference. But for them, it appeared it was business as usual, head in the sand attitude. And that, presiding officer, in these challenging times is not good enough. We need to make sure that we work together to find new solutions, new ideas, while at the same time delivering service. We need to have a mature debate while we're having this, because this is what the public wants. I'll take Mr Findlay now if he wants.
Neil Findlay.
All right.
George Adam.
He wanted in. He wanted in, so fair enough. Mr Bibby, any more?
Neil
Mr.
Bibby.
Was it a fair funding settlement for local authorities when you were a councillor, Mr Adam, between 2007 and 2012, when you voted to cut 200 teachers from schools in Renfrewshire?
Intervention through the chair, please. George Adam.
The whole point we have to say here is to Mr Bibby is it's time to move on and deal with the issue now. Our public, please. And our constituents. And Mr Bibby, when him and I meet in the Hustings and Paisley,
Mr Adam, can you stop for a moment?
And I will.
Can I have order, please? George Adam.
Thank you. Well, Mr Bibby, well, I will get a chance during the debate in the election. I'll defend our case and he can defend his. And his is not a good one because I know which one the public actually trusts. So when you look at what we've actually had, the situation where the Scottish Government is continually trying partner organisations to try and ensure that we get what the public actually want. But the Government is also, with the Westminster Austerity Programme, it also seeks to make the Westminster Austerity Programme seeks to make the old, the weak and the disabled, the ones who suffer the most, it seeks to make them suffer for others' excesses. But this budget seeks to help those I have already mentioned. £35 million to fully mitigate against the bedroom tax, maintaining funding for prescription and eye checks and free concessionary travel for older, disabled and young people. All of the above the opposition callously call the free stuff. But these are things that are helping every man, woman and child in Scotland and are valued by members of our community. So in closing, presiding officer, I would say that once again, the Scottish Government is standing up for all Scots during very difficult, challenging times. From a distant, uncaring Westminster Government that has no love for our communities, I know who my constituents believe and trust with our national finances and future. And I look forward in the coming weeks to the campaign ahead to see how the opposition parties explain their part in all this.
Thank you. I now call Jenny Mara to be followed by John Mason.
Presiding officer, Dundee is facing £23 million of cuts to local services. This is the worst local government settlement in real terms across the whole of Scotland. The SNP tell us that there is no alternative. They say these cuts are coming from Westminster. Now, the cut that is coming from George Osborne in real terms to Scotland is 4.7%, but the cut coming from John Swinney to Dundee is 5.5%. An enhanced package of cuts for Dundee and other deprived areas across Scotland. Austerity plus. With the exception of teachers, presiding officer, every employee, and Joan McAlpine might want to listen to this, every employee of Dundee City Council has received a voluntary redundancy notice. The SNP fought the last election, guaranteeing that there would be no public sector compulsory redundancies, which Mr Swinney reiterated today. What he didn't say, that they would be politely and quietly asked to go by letter on their desks. So,
Joe Fitzpatrick.
In the member's own words, can she understand the difference between voluntary and compulsory?
Jenny Mara.
Yes, and you have asked every council worker in Dundee, with the exception of teachers, to go quietly, to take their redundancy. So, while council staff in Dundee read their voluntary redundancy letters, they see the services they have worked so hard to maintain slashed by this settlement from John Swinney. Where will the cuts fall? The SNP's finance convener in Dundee has said that he is happy to maintain the council tax freeze, so he must have prepared his budget, and he must know where the local SNP plan the cuts to fall, but he has yet to come clean with the people of Dundee. Now, what we have is an SNP finance secretary in Edinburgh happy to deliver a Tory budget in Scotland, and an SNP council in Dundee happy to be good foot soldiers and visit that Tory budget on our local services. Stronger for Scotland? I don't think so. So Kezia Dugdale was right yesterday to suggest that people who can afford it should pay a bit more tax, because it is all very well saying that you are stronger for Scotland, praising public services and those who deliver them, while undermining them by delivering eye-watering cuts. Our leader was right to harness the powers of this Parliament. The SNP have been desperate for years for the power to put a penny on tax. They campaigned for a penny on tax in 1999 and again in 2003. And we were reminded of that on TV last night when we saw the First Minister herself campaigning for a penny for Scotland. She says every week that she wants consensus. Now she has it on the most important political issue. The Liberals said last week that they agree with a penny on tax. Kezia Dugdale made Labour's position clear yesterday. And the First Minister now has the power that she has campaigned for all her political life. So I would fully expect the government to seize that power and initiative when it comes to the vote tonight. Because when I heard on the radio yesterday the SNP saying that they wanted to keep things in line with the rest of the UK, I nearly choked on my tea. What utter disarray. Presiding officer, let me go back to Dundee. Last week... Not right now.
Order, please.
Last week, the Scottish Government, with the British Government, announced a huge package of funding to support and diversify the oil and gas industry in Aberdeen and prepare it to seize the opportunities of decommissioning. Now, this is very welcome. For 2 years, I have been raising the opportunities of decommissioning in this chamber. Oil platforms have been sailing down the east coast of Scotland, past Aberdeen and Dundee, on their way down to Hartlepool to be decommissioned there. Now, this seems like a terrible loss of work and industry to Scotland and the North East. So I have written to the First Minister, to Amber Rudd, the UK Energy Secretary, and to David Mundell to ask each of them for a meeting to see how the rest of the North East and Dundee can share in this investment. Because, presiding officer, in Dundee, we need a working river, not just a waterfront. Because we desperately need work, and I think John Swinney knows this. But to add insult to injury, presiding officer, Dundee has been dealt the worst local government settlement in the whole of Scotland, 5.5%, just behind Shetland and the Western Isles. But our levels of poverty and deprivation, as John Swinney knows, are eye-watering in comparison with those places. Now, this insult was exemplified when Dundee's two MPs, Stuart Hosey and Chris Law, elected last year on an anti-austerity agenda, declined to comment on Mr Swinney's cuts to Dundee, saying that the issue was a matter for colleagues north of the border. Presiding officer, this is a disgrace. Presiding officer, this budget and the SNP at best are taking Dundee for granted, but in reality, we are the SNP's sold-out city in Scotland. And I seriously hope at decision time tonight and in his budget, John Swinney can redress this.
Thank you. I call John Mason to be followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And although sometimes it's preferable perhaps to speak at the start of a debate, I think it can also be advantageous to speak near the end and have the opportunity to reflect on what others have said. So the first area I would like to touch on is taxation. And as has already been stated, the Finance Committee focused largely on taxation during its budget study this year, and in particular on the Scottish rate of income tax, which is our significant new power from this April. Some 11 pages of our report were on this subject. Some 11 pages of our report were on this subject, and we spent a considerable amount of time on it. Now, I have to say that I come from a position where, one, I would like to see improved public services paid for by increased taxation, and two, I consider the gap between the rich and the poor too wide, and that we should try and rectify this by increasing both revenue taxation and capital taxation. Just let me finish this bit, and I'll take interventions if I've got time at the end. Just on Sunday night, I visited the Lodging House Mission in my constituency, which houses Glasgow's main winter night shelter, run in conjunction with Glasgow City Mission. It has 40 mattresses on the floor, and yet they have had to turn people away some nights, as they are not allowed to take more than 40 on any one night. What kind of society are we in that allows this to happen? So I would happily raise taxes to help redistribute income and wealth much more fairly. Once I've finished this argument, which is some distance to go, we did look in Finance Committee as to whether we could raise SRIT, and the first question was whether SRIT was progressive or not. Would it tax the better off more than those at the bottom? Now, the answer to this is yes, it is progressive, and we had some very useful evidence from Lucy Hunter-Blackthorne. She showed in her evidence that comparing someone earning £25,000 per year with someone earning £125,000 per year, which means their salaries are different by five times, but increasing SRIT by 1.5p would mean that the richer person paid eight times as much in SRIT. So that says to me that it is a progressive tax, and I'm glad to say the Cabinet Secretary agreed with me, although I think the convener of the committee at the time did not. And the main argument against it is that if you put a penny on 20p, that's a 5% increase in tax, and if you put a penny on 40p, it's a 2.5% increase. So from that point of view, I accept it is not progressive. However, as I argue, it is progressive, but what it is certainly not very progressive. And a lot of people on lower incomes at this time could really do without a tax increase. Now, since this report was finalised, we have had the Labour proposal to raise income tax by 1p. And on the surface, that might seem attractive, and I would love to have an extra £400 million to see spent on public services. But the idea does raise a lot of questions, because it has been suggested so late in the day, we have not been able as a committee to examine the practicalities of how it would work. Would local authorities be able to handle a rebate system? What kind of cost would be involved for local authorities to do that? Would those who needed most be able to be properly targeted? Would there be a bureaucratic burden for those applying? Let's remember that when there was pension credit, one-third of pensioners did not apply for what they were entitled to because of the hassle. Would such payments themselves be taxable? We know that Westminster is not cooperative on these kinds of issues. Now, there may be answers to these questions, but the reality is they have not been looked at in any thorough way. We did have witnesses at committee advocating a tax increase, and I was very impressed by NHS Health Scotland, suggesting that the receipts be targeted at health spending for the most in need. But even the STUC suggested that this was a blunt instrument and we would be better off waiting a year to get control of the bands and rates as well. Now, I confess I do find this a difficult question, as I do find raising tax for those who are well off very attractive. But in the end, I'm afraid I fear there are too many people on relatively low incomes who could be seriously hurt by this. And I do consider that we'd be better off waiting just one more year for fuller powers. I will take an intervention at this stage. I think, well, OK, Ms Lamont.
Joanne Lamont.
I commend the member for a very reasoned speech, but I would ask him, do you think that people, like you talk about the homeless people in Glasgow, can wait another year? This is a serious matter. And it just because it's not the most progressive, would you ask your government minister to go and test the arguments and find something better that works better if that's the argument? Don't settle for the detail, but the potential of this money to make a difference to people's lives right now.
John Mason.
I think it would have helped if the Labour Party had brought forward their proposal earlier in the process and we could have looked at it in a bit more detail. I see Mr Rennie has joined us again. And I really have to. He wouldn't let me in for an intervention. But I do want to make
Mr. Mason's in his last minute.
I do want to make the point that I seem to remember a Liberal Democrat minister from Westminster coming here and refusing to give us control when we got SRIT of the rates because they did not want us to make it more progressive. So I think it is a bit rich for Mr. Rennie to come in at this stage and say that we should be raising tax with this very blunt instrument which we have got. Finally, on expenditure, I think one of the strengths of what this government is doing is protecting health spending. If the opposition parties, assuming that we cannot raise tax or we should not raise tax, if the opposition parties want to say there should be more for local government, then they can say that, but that should come as a corollary that health would have to be cut as well. I support this budget.
Thank you very much. Now call James Kelly. 5.5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is indeed a significant debate this afternoon because we have two proposals on the table to vote for as a Parliament. We can support the Labour amendment to put one penny on income tax, which will protect public services. It will protect the jobs, the many thousands of jobs of local council workers that are under threat, and support investment in our schools and ensure that we can put forward a programme which will tackle the attainment gap and continue to promote talent and ultimately will help benefit the Scottish economy. Alternatively, we can support the Scottish Government budget, which slashes council spending by £500 million and will put that investment in schooling under severe threat and undermine help in the economy. It seems to me that when you examine Nicola Sturgeon and John Swinney, they've become not political leaders, but they've become managers. Mr Swinney in particular has become a budget manager, and he's become imprisoned by the accountants at St Andrew's House. And Mr Swinney, you got something to say?
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very grateful to Mr Kelly for letting me intervene. I'll just say out loud what I was muttering to my colleagues around it. I was saying, thank goodness somebody does manage the budget carefully in this Parliament.
James Kelly.
Well, if you'd have been... Yeah, it was worth waiting for, wasn't it? If you'd have been out...
Order, please. Order.
I'll get on with it. See if you'd have been outside earlier on and you had the opportunity to speak to council representatives. You might have been able to explain to them why your budget is going to put thousands of council workers on the dole.
Mr Kelly, through the chair, please.
Mr Stewart.
Kevin Stewart.
I thank Mr Kelly for giving way. Does he not recognise that this morning the Cabinet Secretary was at the Local Government Committee and then the Finance Committee for the budget to be scrutinised, where at the Local Government Committee only one Labour member turned up and asked only one question? Are they so bothered about all
James
of this?
James Kelly.
You know, Deputy Presiding Officer, you know the problem with the SNP is in this debate, all the brave hearts, all the progressive voices... They've all been silenced.
Please.
Listen, look at them all. Look at them all. They're all meek now. Given the opportunity. Given the power. Given the power. Sit down, Mr.
Order,
Stewart.
Order, please,
you
Mr.
Chance.
Kelly. I'll tell
sit
members
down,
to
Mr.
sit
Stewart,
down. Mr.
You
Kelly.
Your chance.
I'll request that members sit down. James Kelly, can we have order, please?
Given the opportunity to take the power, to do something to protect council budgets. What John Swinney has done is he's followed George Osborne's route, he's following the austerity route, and he's following the Tory party cuts.
Order,
why
please.
Not, Ms. Fabiani?
Linda Fabiani.
I was just wondering, Presiding Officer, given everything Mr. Kelly has said, why last year Labour MPs voted with the Tories to enact the spending cuts from public budgets, £30 billion.
James Kelly.
Maybe Ms. Fabiani should get in the TARDIS and get into this time and place. We're debating. We are debating. We're debating the Scottish budget.
Order, please.
That's affecting Scottish communities, Scottish councils. And why don't you, as a government, take some responsibility instead of passing the buck? Because I'll tell you something, Deputy Presiding Officer. It can't be acceptable, as happens in my constituency, where teachers don't have the photocopying facilities to give kids the homework to do, and they ask them to print it out at home, and some of them don't even have computer printers. That can't be acceptable. It can't be acceptable that kids are going to have to walk to school next year because of school transport cuts, because of the effect of the cuts from this SNP government, Ms. Campbell. And it can be acceptable that we get into a position where we have less teachers and less classroom assistants.
Order, please, Mr. Fitzpatrick.
And summing up, Deputy Presiding Officer, the choice is clear. The time for talking has got to stop. It's time to stand up. Stand up and be counted for our communities. Protect the budgets, protect the council workers' jobs, and protect our local communities.
We now turn to the winding up speeches and are calling Gavin Brown, maximum 6 minutes, please, Mr. Brown.
Well, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It has indeed been a most unique debate because for the first time in a couple of years, the Labour Party have come to the Chamber with a policy, Presiding Officer. Yes, it might not be the same policy as last week, it might not be the same policy as next week, but my goodness, it is a policy. And it is extremely unfair of the Scottish Government to say that they haven't taken any evidence on this policy and it's all done on the back of a fag packet. Because for months, through the Finance Committee and through the Labour Party, we have taken evidence on this policy. We've heard from businesses, we've heard from councils, we've heard from the third sector, we've heard from trade unions, we have had a morass of evidence. But the Labour Party has just ignored all of the evidence, apart from one submission, and adopted it as a policy. Presiding Officer, I have to say to the Scottish Government, I hope they don't feel bowed by the Labour Party and their new friends in the Liberal Democrats. I hope Mr. Swinney stands true to his word and his opening statement today in refusing to implement an income tax increase for the hard-working population of Scotland. Because the economic impact, as we saw in evidence and again for those of us who turned up to committee, we saw, Deputy Presiding Officer, that it would not be good for those workers, it would not be good for the economy of Scotland. And I urge, once again, the Finance Secretary to confirm in his closing speech that he will not be bowed by the proposal from the Labour Party. Now, our problem with the budget is a different one, Deputy Presiding Officer, as outlined by Murdo Fraser both today in negotiations and in previous statements he's made to the press. Our first concern is that this budget, in line with the last couple of budgets, just makes Scotland that little bit less competitive. And on a year-to-year basis, some of these things are noticed less and less. But in the medium term, by chipping away at our competitive position, I think we could store up problems for the future. We complained bitterly last year about the residential rates for the land and building transactions tax. We felt that while it was right to give a break to first-time buyers, we were concerned about what would happen in other sectors of the market. And we remain concerned today about what could happen there going forward. We're concerned about the residential market. In terms of the commercial part of land and buildings transaction tax, the top rate of tax may be only marginally higher than the rest of the UK, but sometimes being only marginally higher can count against you. And I think we need to try and have every advantage that we possibly can and erode or remove any disadvantages. We heard about the empty property charges. Now, we've fought hard against that
legislation when it came in. At the time, though, the Scottish Government's position was that we still had a competitive advantage because they had an exemption for industrial property. But in this budget, the plan is to remove that exemption for industrial property, again taking away one of the advantages we may have had. And we have big concerns with the large business supplement, a measure that was introduced without consultation, without any impact assessment, and one which we're hearing from larger businesses could cause problems and could cause businesses to choose to invest in other parts of the UK instead of investing in Scotland. For example, does it apply to oil and gas businesses too? Businesses who have been hit hard over the last year or so. We hear about all sorts of forums going on in the north of Scotland and up in Aberdeen, but will they be hit specifically by this large business supplement? Because in my reading of it, they will. And we've just doubled the large business supplement for businesses who are severely struggling. Yeah, of course I'll give you.
Matt MacDonald.
I hear what Gavin Brown's saying, and he's mentioned the evidence that we took at Finance Committee. Would he also accept that the Finance Committee did not receive any evidence opposing this supplement?
That's not technically correct. I mean, members individually, of course, and I'm sure Mr MacDonald was one, did receive a number of submissions. He will, of course, recall that the actual when we tendered out for evidence, that was before the announcement of that. So, yeah, he's technically correct. But given that businesses at that point, when we went to consultation, didn't know about the large business supplement, it would have been unusual for them to have complained about it, given that they hadn't heard about it yet. Presiding officer, our second problem is that the government again attempts to hide some of the reality. Some of the bad news within this budget, they obfuscate, they refuse to give clear and plain answers, and we're still asking questions and not getting the right answers. They say, for example, that housing is an absolute priority for this government, yet when we pointed out on Budget Day back in December that actually the housing budget appears to be cut by £1 million, a small cut, presiding officer, but he cut nonetheless for a budget that is said to be an absolute priority. We're told on the day that affordable housing is up by £100 million, but they do not tell us what is being cut in order to fund that. We understand that the Help to Buy budget is being absolutely hammered, but when I asked the Scottish Government today at question time what is happening to the Help to Buy budget, I was just given a three-year figure. The number that sounds big, £195 million, but if that's over 3 years, that's a pretty big cut if you divide that by three. Presiding officer, in closing, I just want to say this. In terms of oversight of the budget, we have issues too. The Fiscal Commission did sign off on this budget. They did say it was reasonable, but they admitted clearly to the Finance Committee that they didn't examine any of the outputs whatsoever. They admitted they would have no idea of what numbers would be unreasonable. And despite having increasing concerns about the lack of behavioural analysis on the revenue numbers, they still were prepared to pass it as reasonable. That was something we'll come to as that piece of legislation
goes through. You need to close, Mr Brown.
But I'm content to leave it there, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Brown. I now call Alec Rowley. Alec, Mr Rowley, you've got 8 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In opening up today or closing today for Labour, I would first want to acknowledge all those council workers and the shop stewards and all the people that have travelled from across Scotland to lobby this Parliament today, not to put the case for higher wages, not to put the case for more pay, but to put the case for their jobs, for their colleagues' jobs and for public services across Scotland. Can I say that in any budget, and as an opposition party looking at a budget, of course there will be proposals within that budget and there will be monies within that budget that are to be welcomed. And I have already put on record the acknowledgement that the £250 million that was going into health and social care was something to be welcomed. There is clearly still discussions to take place with local government who still seem unclear as to some of the detail of that and the conditions that are around it. But nevertheless, given the major difficulties that we have right across Scotland in terms of social care, that was welcomed. And I have also said, whilst we would go further in terms of housing, and it is important that we now actually make the housing happen, but we do have a housing crisis in Scotland and it needs to be tackled, and again, the additional funding that was put place there. But in terms of being in opposition, it is about about weighing that budget up and weighing up the good things within the budget and deciding whether they outweigh the negatives in terms of whether or not you can support that budget. And sadly, for this time round, we find ourselves in a position where we cannot support Mr Swinney's budget. For all the bluster and the shouting that has taken place in this chamber today, for all the financial detail of the budget, we should never lose sight of the fact that what we're speaking about actually is people's lives. It is the impact of this budget on people's lives, and it is the impact of this budget in terms of communities up and down Scotland. Last week, I visited a project that was set up.
Kevin Stewart.
It is right to speak about people's lives. And what we have seen in terms of the Labour proposal is an omission. And that omission is how the rebate system would actually work. No one from the Labour benches has outlined that today. Could Mr Rowley please outline how that rebate system would work? Because if it doesn't work, that will have a major impact on people's lives.
Alex Rowley.
There is a clear choice in terms of this budget. There is a clear choice that you can cut Scotland's future or you can invest for Scotland's future. And on this side of this chamber, we will invest in Scotland's future. I don't forget the fact that when we announced that we would reverse the tax credit cuts that were coming from the Tory Chancellor, we were told that we couldn't do that. You know, the government and the supporters said that that couldn't be done, and then you had to move for that position. All we seem to be getting today is being told why the rebate cannot work. We are absolutely confident that the rebate can work, but we are absolutely happy to sit down with the government and have that discussion, as we are with local authorities. But we have talked to local authorities across Scotland, and we're confident that
Mr. Stewart,
the
member's not giving way.
If I can move back to where I was at. This budget is about real people at the end of the day, Presiding Officer. Last week I visited a project that was set up that supports disabled people who want to be able to shop in our town centres, and they've been told by the local authority that their monies are going to be cut. In terms of early years investment, there is threats to budgets up and down the length and the breadth of Scotland. And if we were having a joined-up strategy and a joined-up budget in Scotland, then we'd not be cutting early years off the most needed in our communities, because we know that children by the age of 3 or 4 might already have had their path outlined for them. And that's why there has been an emphasis by local government across Scotland to invest in early years. All these kinds of projects are in danger of being cut, and that impacts on real people's lives. I also said that I welcomed the fact, and Joan McAlpine in her speech talked about the living wage. And I, for one, have campaigned and said that we need to introduce a living wage across the care sector. It cannot be right, and it is not right, that the majority of care workers in the private sector get no more than the minimum wage. So on that, we can agree. But when we talk about ill-considered, ill-thought-out proposals coming forward, then I would have to say to you that if the third sector are expected to pay 25% of the living wage, then I'm not sure that that will actually work. Indeed, it was Mr Swinney himself a few years ago who paid the local authorities to increase the national rate in the private sector. So again, I'm not sure that that will work. But the very principle of introducing a living wage across the care sector, of course, we will support that as we move forward. But another criticism that I have of this budget is that we'd have to ask, where is the strategic focus of a joined-up strategy for moving Scotland forward and moving its futures forward? I would have to say that I am concerned, Presiding Officer, about the economy of Scotland right now. How many task force do we have up and running in Scotland? 65,000 jobs have gone in oil and gas, and we rightly have a task force trying to address that. We've had task force for the coal sector, where the open cast jobs have gone. In Fife, I sit on a task force, along with Mr Swinney, because of the job losses that went there. We have a task force for steel. We have a task force in Glenrothes for the electronics and semiconductor industry. Indeed, if you look right across Scotland, there is not much left of the electronics industry. Faced with those stark realities about where our economy in Scotland is now, I ask myself, where in this budget is there any inclination that we're moving towards an investment strategy and a development strategy to put Scotland's economy back on track? I certainly cannot see it within the budget that's there. Mr Swinney, in his comments, talked about the reforms of public services. I welcomed when the government brought forward the Christie report that said we needed prevention. But you will not be able to create that type of investment in prevention if you're cutting public services. This is a backward step. This is not looking to the future of Scotland, it's looking backward. But let me also be clear, because the First Minister quite wrongly in this chamber earlier last week said that Labour were pushing for a deal on the fiscal framework at any cost. We're absolutely clear that, of course, it must be fair to Scotland, and absolutely it must be consistent with the principles of the Smith Agreement. But the people of Scotland will never forgive us if we fail to get an agreement, and that's why we must work night and day to ensure that we get an agreement for Scotland. Presiding officer, I think my time's up, but I would want to say that none of us in this chamber should take our eye off the fact that what we're talking about here is real people. We're talking about real jobs. We're talking about real communities. So let's work together to ensure that we actually invest in Scotland's future. Support Labour's amendment.
I now call on John Swinney to wind up the debate. Deputy First Minister, till 5 o'clock, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin, first of all, with the latter remarks of Mr Rowley about the fiscal framework, because I've heard, I've heard a lot of things from the Labour Party which have criticised me for supposedly not putting body and soul into trying to resolve the fiscal framework agreement. And I specifically refer to the stream of comments from Ian Murray, the Shadow Secretary of State for Scotland, which have essentially doubted the energy that I've put in to try to resolve this issue. The reason why we don't have a fiscal framework agreement just now is because there is no basis for it to be agreed that's consistent with the Smith Commission. And I will not sign up to any document that is not consistent with the Smith Commission report. So if the Labour Party... And there are no games being played here. I take deadly seriously my responsibilities as the Finance Secretary in this country. And if anybody believes that I would do anything other than try to get an agreement that A, was consistent with Smith, B, that was good for Scotland, and C, that enabled us to exercise the powers that we are supposed to be able to exercise under the Scotland Act 2016, well, they doubt the whole purpose of my adult political life. And, well, I'm sure this will be helpful.
Neil Findlay.
Always try to be helpful to Mr Swinney. Why does he then expect council leaders to sign up to a deal that makes them considerably worse off?
Deputy First Minister.
Look, I'll come on to that in a second, but let me just conclude the fiscal... Well, I will do. I'm going to. Plenty of time for it. But I'm going to conclude my point in the fiscal framework, because it has to be understood the seriousness of the situation we find ourselves in on this question. And there are no party politics being played here. This is about the national interest of Scotland, and I encourage all parties to think that through as we go into a very difficult couple of weeks in trying to resolve these issues. Murdo Fraser has... Willie Rennie was raising some points about Murdo Fraser's not having some suggestions or explanations as to how his long list of spending commitments would be paid for. I have some sympathy with Mr Rennie, because Mr Fraser put a press release out on the 31st of January with all the things that are wrong with the budget and all the extra spending the Conservatives are going to put out, and said that I was being sent a letter which would explain how it was all being paid for. And it's now Wednesday and I've yet to receive the letter. So if I could have the letter sent to me, it would be helpful. We'll have it at the end of the afternoon. Thank you. And I'll look at it in great detail so that I can address those points. Now, on the larger business supplement that Mr Fraser and Mr Brown were talking about, the impact of the increase in the large business supplement is to put an annual increase on the business rates for companies that pay the large business supplement of 3.4% in 2016-17. In 2011, the comparative number was 4.6%, and in 2012-13, it was 5.8% in much more difficult economic conditions than we find today. So I would put the large business supplement into the context of that explanation, which demonstrates why it's appropriate and sustainable at this time. Patrick Harvey raised the issues around climate change, and we will, of course, engage on these questions as we go through the budget process. But the principal difference between the budget this year and last year on issues in connection with climate change have been the removal of ring-fenced funds from the United Kingdom government that are specifically targeted at climate change measures, which I have been unable to replace because of spending cuts from the United Kingdom government. I'll give way to Mr.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Perhaps he could tell us whether the dramatic increase in the road building budget is also the result of the UK government's decisions, or is this a question of his own priorities?
Well, the decisions on capital projects are, of course, are decisions that we take to improve the infrastructure of the country. And as Mr Harvey will know, there are a whole range of different projects that are enhancing the rail infrastructure of the country. And indeed, just last week, we announced additional funding to improve connectivity and journey times between the northeast of Scotland and the Central Belt as part of the Aberdeen City deal that the United Kingdom Government and the Scottish Government brought forward. And then Mr Rennie was raising, obviously setting out his arguments on the tax issue, and he has, of course, rather changed his political argument and agenda on this point. Mr Rennie, for 5 years, made absolutely no attempt in this Parliament to disassociate himself from the swingeing reductions in public expenditure that were delivered by the United Kingdom Government, for which we had to wrestle with the consequences. So I take not at all seriously suddenly the Liberal Democrats' renewed connection and interest with increasing public spending after the damage that they associated themselves with in the Conservative Government over the last 5 years. Now, let me move to the issue of the local government budget, an issue that was raised by Mr Finlay and others in the debate. And I want to make a number of points in relation to this debate. The first is that in the resource budget is proposed in grant and aid to reduce by £350 million. There will be £150 million of capital funding removed from local authority budgets for 16-17, but it will be put into local authority budgets later in the spending review period. And we did that arrangement in the last Parliament, and local government, who got a lower capital budget at the start of the period, had a larger capital budget at the end of the period, and all of the commitments that I gave to local government honoured. And in addition to that, local government is going to get 26% of the capital DEL available to the Scottish Government, not just for the next 3 years, but for the next 4 years, as a consequence of the agreement that I have put to local government as a consequence. So, I will, yes?
Will there any?
I can't understand his position on this. If the deal for local government is so great, why has he had to impose this triple lock, this triple whammy on councils with fines of £408 million? How could that make sense if it's so appealing?
I'm simply applying that approach because I want to make sure that the three things that matter, the integration of health and social care, the protection of teacher numbers, the delivery of the council tax freeze, and as part of the integration of health and social care, the payment of the living wage to care workers. I just want to make sure those things happen, because I think they're very important that they happen. So, whilst the local government resource budget is falling by £350 million, we are injecting £250 million into the integration of health and social care, in which local authorities are key participants. And what that £250 million will be able to do is it will be able to afford more care packages that currently today are not able to be provided. So that directly addresses the financial pressures on local government. It also enables local authorities, as I've explained in my letter to the President of COSLA, issued to all local authority leaders, that it enables local authorities to find the financial support to pay the living wage that we've talked about for social care workers and to address pressures in the delivery of existing social care services. So the reduction of £350 million in the local authority budget is tempered by the injection of £250 million. The difference of that is less than 1% of the total expenditure of local government. So some of the rhetoric we have heard about this being a catastrophic fall in local authority expenditure is utterly misplaced in this debate. We have invested heavily to afford our priorities on behalf of the people of Scotland. Now, the last topic I want to cut, I'm going to close on the issues in relation to income tax.
Well, I don't think
the Labour Party can moan about the amount of times I give way to the Labour Party in these debates. Mr Rowley, and I agree with Mr Rowley on this, this is all about people's lives. It is about people's lives. And the choice that we've made is that we've decided not to increase tax on the incomes of low-income households within Scotland. That's the choice we've made. And the Labour Party say that, of course, they've got this rebate mechanism. We've had 2 hours of 20 minutes of debate this afternoon, and not one single piece of detail has been offered as to how this rebate could be paid to members of the public. Now, if the Labour Party had wanted some clues about the difficulty of this issue, they need only have gone to the Finance Committee official report of the 13th of January 2016. And on this occasion, I can share with Parliament, Jackie Bailey was present for the Finance Committee debate. She was there. She was an active participant in the discussion. And I set out the reasons why increasing the tax for low-income households and thinking that it could be tempered by a rebate of some mechanism to target it on those individuals was unable to be delivered within the powers of this Parliament. And those arguments were set out clearly on the official report in a damn sight more detail than we've had from the Labour Party about the arguments why it is the case, to inform Parliament about why I came to the conclusion I came to. And the conclusion I came to was the right thing to do is at this time is to protect the incomes of low-income households, to invest in integration of health and social care, to freeze the council tax, and I hope Parliament will support that at 5 o'clock.
That concludes the debate. Order! Mr Findlay, I'm speaking. That concludes the debate on the Budget Scotland No. 5 Bill. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15565 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting a revision to the business programme for Thursday the 4th of February. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15565.
Moved.
No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15565 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15543 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15543.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15543 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15542. In the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a stage 2 timetable for the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15542.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15542, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15546 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on the timetable for the Stage 1 debate of the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Amendment Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15546.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15546, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of 6 Parliamentary Bureau motions. I'd ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions to number 15547 to 15549 on approval of SSIs en bloc. And
moved.
Motions not, and and motions number 15550 and 15544 and 15545 on the suspension and variation of standing orders and the designation of lead committee en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. The question on these motions will be put to decision time, to which we now come. There are 4 questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is amendment number 15522.1 in the name of Jackie Bailey, which seeks to amend motion number 15522 in the name of John Swinney on the Budget Scotland number 5 bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 15522.1 in the name of Jackie Bailey is as follows. Yes, 43. No, 81. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question, order. The next question is that motion number 15522 in the name of John Swinney on the Budget Scotland number 5 bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 15522 in the name of John Swinney is as follows. Yes, 63. No, 46. There were 15 abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. I propose to ask a single question on motions number 15547 to 15549 on approval of SSIs. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motions number 15547 to 15549 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of SSIs be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motions are therefore agreed to. I propose to ask a single question on motions number 15550, 15544 and 15545 on the suspension variation of standing orders and the designation of lead committee. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put, therefore I now put the questions to the Chamber. The question is that motions number 15550, 15544 and 15545 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the suspension variation of standing orders and the designation of lead committee be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should leave quickly and quietly.